Our next speaker that I'm going to introduce is Kevin Larsen. Unlike Patrick and Lawrence, there are no C-sections between Kevin and I. So Kevin is employed by the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services in the United States, and he does a lot of work in health information technology policy for CMS. He's also faculty at the University of Minnesota. Previously, he was medical director of meaningful use at the National Coordinator for Health Information Technology in the US. And I think that phrase means a lot to those of us in the United States working in clinical decision support. He was also, before that, chief medical information officer at Hennepin County Medical Center. And Kevin's going to speak to the United States government perspective on this topic. Kevin?
Thank you. I apologize, I have no slides. My computer crashed yesterday and I couldn't resuscitate them, so you'll get me from notes. It's really terrific to be here. I'm a general internist, which is why there's no C-sections, although I did lots of them in medical school. Really excited to be part of an international crowd, so also very interested in the back and forth and discussion after this is done. So I'm going to speak about the federal context. I work for the Department of Health and Human Services, which is the U.S. Ministry of Health. It's a very large Ministry of Health. We're about 90,000 employees across the U.S. Because we have a lot of different functions. The function I'm working on now is the health insurance, the Center for Medicare and Medicaid Services. But I previously was at the National Coordinator for Health Information Technology. And that is, I think, a unique office maybe in the world, although I could be wrong, that we had a staff, or we have a staff of almost 200 people focused just on health information technology, policy, and implementation in the US. How many of you use smartphones out here? A lot of people do. How many of you use Google Maps or something similar? So that's my vision for the future. What do we like about Google Maps? Why do we use it? Well, it's personalized to me. It knows right where I'm at. It knows the options I have in front of me. It says, do you want to walk? Do you want to drive? Do you want to bike? And it tells me that what the traffic's going to be like. If you take this route, you're going to go this fast. If you take this route, you're going to go that fast. So that, to my mind, is what a guideline should look like for a patient or a doctor. That if I am diagnosed with breast cancer, I should be able to say, this is me, this is my breast cancer, this is my details as a patient, these are my preferences. And then the science and the choices are laid out before me and I can pick one with my doctor. And then if I get partway down that path and I want to change because it got rainy or the road was bad, I can change my path and it recalculates and says, okay, now you want to go down this path, go down that path instead. So if we hold that out as our vision for where we want guidelines to go, the question is, what do we need to do to backtrack to get there? And that's a lot of what many of us are working on in the health information technology space. So there's a combination of technology solutions that we need to work on. There's also an approach to how we think about guidelines and how we think about evidence that we need to work on. An example of the latter, I won't go into this too much, but in my prior work doing research in guidelines and health IT, I did a similar small-scale model of that for asthma and took an asthma guideline and integrated it for patients and doctors to use together. What we found is that the asthma guideline as written was complicated, which was actually probably good, but it wasn't ready for the computer. There were places that the guideline committee hadn't considered. For example, children with severe asthma, if you followed the algorithm, it said you should give them steroids. But there was a black box warning on that drug that said don't give children steroids. So there was no recommendation for one part of the guideline. And we called and called and called the guideline committee and said, can you help us? And they said, well, we're done. Our committee, you know, went away. Nobody's around anymore. And so we didn't have a way as the the technology implementers of that guideline to make a recommendation in a key part of the guideline because there was nothing in the guideline about it. The other things that we want to be sure happen, much like Google Maps, is that it's secure, it's safe, you feel that your information is being protected. We want it to be easy to understand. So our vision, at least in the US, is that the consumers, US citizens and others, have this information themselves. This isn't just held by the providers, that it's information that's shared and used together. And then it's easily updated, so that if there's new evidence, if there's new information that comes out, that new evidence can actually be pushed to consumers, or pushed to providers, or just readily available. I don't know how many of you used the first version of Apple's Maps, and that it didn't have all the right roads. And there was nothing more frustrating than driving, thinking you're getting recommendations, and that road's no longer there, it's been moved. So those are the kinds of things that we're going to have to figure out in healthcare to make sure that this technology stays live and updated and accurate in ways that we often haven't done before as a guideline community. So what have we been doing at the U.S. Ministry of Health? The program that I was the medical director of, the Meaningful Use Program, is a program that's still ongoing that gave incentives, gave money to doctors and to hospitals to purchase electronic medical records, electronic health records, and put them into their systems, into their practice. So now in the U.S., about 95% of all hospitals have electronic health records, and about 60% of all physician offices have electronic health records. Even more importantly, and this was where the government's priority was, we set a set of baseline standards that all of those records have to follow. So that when they capture your name and your address and your date of birth, they all capture it the same way. So that when you move from one hospital to another hospital, the information can easily flow back and forth. Well, why is that important for a guideline community thinking about Google Maps? That is how we can potentially scale these things up. We have to have enough consistency in how we're collecting data and storing data, and enough consistency in how our technology works, so that when we have a new guideline or a new app that would come online, imagine if guidelines were apps like an Apple App Store, and one of those you want to just load into your smartphone, it only can connect if it's using and storing data the same way that your phone is already using and storing data. So there's a lot of actual clinical work that needs to be done there. That's why there are physicians working on this in the government. For example, blood pressure. I can't tell you how many hours of meetings we spent to figure out how many different kinds of blood pressure we need to have captured to use. Is it one? Well, nobody thinks it should be one, because some blood pressure is captured for screening purposes, some is captured for diagnostic purposes, some is in the emergency department, some is captured using an automated cuff, and some is captured using a manual cuff. How much of that nuance and detail is important when you're going to use that blood pressure for a guideline versus how much of it isn't important? And our goal, again, at the government was to set the minimum standard so when it said blood pressure, any app that you would use would find blood pressure and everybody would know what it was and it could be reused and reused and reused. So those are some of the kinds of issues that we as a network have to resolve and figure out. What do we want as our core set of baseline information that we want to reuse across things in order for this to work? So my office that I worked in, the National Coordinator for Health IT, we set these standards across the government. And then the way that we enforced these standards was through requiring that the people that build and develop electronic medical records test those and prove that they can meet the standards. So a lot of my job and the job of our agency is to create detailed testing programs. So if you're a company, and I saw Allscripts was here, they're one of these companies. Allscripts has a large number of products actually that they sell to the American market Any of those that they would want to be used for this program have to come in and get tested and then get certified that they're capturing blood pressure in the same way, that they're capturing name in the same way, that they're capturing date of birth in the same way, and that that information is actually accessible in the same way for people to use like an app. And so for those of you that are more geeky and technology-oriented, it's essentially versions of XML that we need to figure out, and we were having a discussion up here. It's things like metadata standards and ontologies and data models, and a lot of that stuff we have to try to resolve and then write government policy around. So that's the funny part of this, is we have to not only know that, we have to figure out which parts of it we write policy around. And if we go too deep in the weeds, we hear that you went too deep in the weeds, please, government, don't overregulate us. But if we don't create enough consistency, it's very hard for that information to be reused over and over again. So those data standards are out there, they exist. If any of you are interested, they're available on the internet. We actually publish, as the Office of the National Coordinator for Health IT, not just the standards that we regulate, but what we think are the best available standards in any given year, as a way to try to give some guidance to the industry as the industry tries to choose what should I use for this, what should I use for that. The kind of standards that we use are data standards. We use standards around structure, we use standards around privacy security, we use standards around access. The work that I was deeply involved in were the quality standards. And for that, the quality standards are standards of both decision support and quality measurement. Because part of this program is to use electronic medical records to routinely and reliably measure health outcomes directly from the practice and the data the practice is capturing in their technology. So take this example of blood pressure. We have quality measures that look to see, is the blood pressure at the guideline goal? And it automatically pulls that out of the electronic health record, it compiles that, creates a numerator and denominator, and that is your measurement of, was your blood pressure at goal? Nobody's abstracting, no one's looking through, the computer is picking and pulling that and telling you. I will not stand up here and say this is perfect now. There's been a lot of learning and a lot of work by everybody involved to figure out how to do that well. But though that kind of quality measurement standard, the goal is to help practices know, are they on track? Are they actually guideline adherent? Are they achieving what they want to achieve by things like having their blood pressure at goal in their practices? And then in the US, we're moving to a system of paying for value. So we want to pay for the outcomes of those measures rather than paying for the number of visits that someone has had. So the goal from a US policy perspective is to pay the doctors that get more blood pressure controlled more money than the doctors that get less blood pressure controlled, regardless of how many visits they have. So all of this is kind of moving in this policy of focusing on value and using good data to know what that is, and ideally automating as much of that data as possible so that the practice isn't spending all their time recalculating the data or abstracting the data. There's the quality measurement portion of this. We haven't really regulated much of the decision support part. We've just said that we think decision support is important and we require that you have it, but that you can have it in any number of ways that you want. And just tell us that you've done it and be ready to have someone and show it to someone if you need to. But we are working on keeping the data standards very aligned between decision support and quality measurement so that the same blood pressure you get alerted about is the blood pressure you get measured about. Other things we're doing in the federal government is to try to create this a set of resources that people could use for free around guidelines. So an example of that, you might think of it like an app store. Right now, the US government, especially the Centers for Disease Control, CDC, which is another part of our Ministry of Health, does a lot of development of decision support aids, often they're electronic, often they're web-based, to help people make decisions about key diseases. One example from last year was Zika, the Zika virus. As that was emerging, how do we use technology to push Zika recommendations onto the web for providers to use? We are now looking and working across HHS. I saw a couple of people here from the Agency for Health Research and Quality. That's another part of the ministry. So we're working with the Centers for Disease Control and AHRQ to create a sort of more standardized way to collect these and to display them and for you to use them like an app store. So how would it be that each and every disease or component isn't just doing it in a different way? How are we saying they're doing it the same way, and their same way we know easily connects to the way that all these electronic health records already work? And the standards are kind of the key that connects those two things. Another example that we are soon to release is one from Medicare, actually, and it is a pretty sophisticated cardiovascular risk guideline. We are launching a new program to pay for pay practices more money for the amount of cardiovascular risk they reduce. So it will be based on this national algorithm that calculates cardiovascular risk. It's called the Million Hearts model. And it's part of a Million Hearts campaign to reduce heart attack and stroke by a million over 5 years. And so this model then will connect. This is not only what the practice will be paid on, but it will be how they will be measuring their own success. How effective are they at reducing overall cardiovascular risk by their practice? I apologize for the non-data geeks. We'll be using an API, an application programming interface, for practices ideally to be able to, in a live way, connect to this Million Hearts cardiovascular risk calculator. So what does that mean? It means it will take data like the blood pressure, like the age, like the BMI, some key lab data, and that can be sent in real time to a government computer that will then calculate the risk score and in real time send it right back to the practice. And then practice then will know, are they making progress or not making progress? We also have some more far-reaching, I'll come back to that in a second. Then there's this sort of really interesting policy question about once these become available and they become a little more black box, they're not so easy to read through as a paper-based guideline might be, what's the role of government in assuring that they're of high quality, high clinical quality, and high safety? I would say that that's unresolved in the U.S. The Veterans Administration, the group that provides care for veterans, which is another federal group, they are working on a kind of app store of apps for veterans to help them with healthcare. And what would it look like for the Veterans Administration to review and approve and say these apps are safe and reliable and validated by the government? We've been working with the National Health Service in the UK. They're working to do a similar thing. So far in the US, we have not been focused on that as a national priority. It's a commercial marketplace now. Some of the more future-looking things that we're working on, you may or may not have heard of the President's Precision Medicine Initiative, which is a large-scale government initiative to incorporate the genetic data and other kind of personal information, phenotypic data, into a standardized approach like an electronic health record. And then that information would be the substrate, would be the information used to make recommendations. So there's a lot of active research going on in that area, not just research in the, what do we do with this genetic information, but from my place, the standards and the way that we standardize how that data is collected, stored, how that data is secured, and how that data would be accessed for use by things like guidelines and things like guideline applications. So that's coming. To my mind, maybe even more exciting is this idea of an alerting health system. So how is this not just a one-way push, but a two-way chain So the information we're learning from practices comes back to our guidelines and comes back to our algorithms in a constantly learning approach. One of my colleagues calls this practice-based evidence, so that we're continually capturing from the practices what they know, what they learn, because the data is flowing in two ways and we're constantly learning in this bi-directional approach. If you use a number of the apps do this, like if you ever use Waze, which is available in the US, it's an app that helps with maps. You actually tell it where there are problems on the road, and that's how it learns there was an accident. That's how it learns that there is a road that's out, because someone's constantly telling it. How do we think about that in our guideline approach? I'll leave you with just a few kind of open questions that aren't resolved, but love to have a conversation and some dialogue after this. One of the issues is identity and security, that we need to really be sure that as this becomes more available, we keep it secure, we protect patients' and consumers' information. And that is harder to do than it sounds. Another I kind of highlighted at the beginning is the computer readiness of guidelines. A lot of the guidelines we take in at the federal government and we work to automate weren't really built in a way to think about how they could be used in computers. So there's some question and probably some active work and research, and maybe many of you are doing this, to say how do we build guidelines that are computer ready? And some of that is that they don't miss places like this issue for children with asthma, but also how frequently are they updated? If someone calls and says, hey, guideline committee, we think there's a problem, is there a way to actually update that guideline in this real-time way? If you're getting all this data from consumers, can the committee take that in and handle it? There's also an issue with the business model. I think the guideline community right now is often a research community, often a we do this for free model, which can be great. But to answer a couple of those earlier questions, there may need to be more of a business model that actually pays for people's time and energy to do the kind of real-time and detailed work that needs to happen. And the final one, which is near and dear to my heart, as someone who's passionate about user-centered design, these work best when they're really easy to use and deeply integrated into how you do your work. And that last mile problem is one that is often not thought about and often not solved. We create a cool looking something or other, a pretty app, a pretty cool thing, and then when we actually look, no one is using it. One of the statistics I heard from a healthcare researcher is that 95% of the apps in the Apple App Store get downloaded and used one time or less by their users. And so we can, as researchers, create lots and lots of cool, shiny objects. The question is not what's the coolest, shiniest object, but the question is what's the one that's really useful and that people really want. So with that, I'll close and look forward to questions later.